the past few months, we have diving deeper into the world of PCG and experimenting with different techniques to generate content for our projects. It's been an exciting journey, and we discovered a lot about procedural generation and how to create unique and interesting experiences. In this video, we are going to share with you what we have learned about PCG. We will take a look how it works and how to use it to generate some good content in Unity. So sit back, relax, and join us on this PCG adventure. The first step is to understand what procedural generation means. At first, it can seem scary or even magical, and it's often confused with randomness. But procedural generation is not random. Let's think about it as a set of rules or algorithms to automatically generate data or content. The key difference between procedural generation and random generation is that with procgen, we have control over the rules and we can adjust them to produce specific type of content. This means that while the results maybe appear unpredictable, they are actually deterministic. In other words, randomization alone does not generate something meaningful, which is something that procgen can do. Let's do an example. We can ask our PC to generate a series of numbers, in which each number is the sum of the two preceding ones, also known as the Fibonacci series. Well, this is really basic, but it is in fact an example of procgen. And you can even do art with that. Let's try with something more visual. In Unity, there is a built-in component that is a perfect example of procedural, the particle system. You have a bunch of models and you can customize them, their rules, to achieve a lot of different results. Every little change has a huge impact on the final effect. Of course, remaining deterministic doesn't mean that procgen cannot take advantage of random, or pseudo-random to be more precise. In fact, randomness is used a lot, driven by a seed. Imagine the random function as a black box that takes your input and returns an arbitrary value as output. You cannot foresee the output because you don't know what happens inside it. However, there is a way to do that. Because there is a secret input that determines the initial state of the random sequence, the seed. The seed is a value that you provide to the random function, usually a number, that serves as a starting point for generating the values. If you use the same seed, you will get the same sequence of random values every time, which is useful for creating reproducible output. This is because the random function is actually a deterministic algorithm that uses a mathematical formula to generate seemingly random numbers based on the seed and the other internal state variables. The output appears random because the formula is designed to be very sensitive to changes in the seed and the other inputs. So even small differences in the input values will result in a very different output sequences. In short, the seed is what we use to keep our result deterministic. Okay, that's well and good, but how we can use procedural generation to create something truly magical? We are used to seeing a lot of video games that use procgen as a way to create a bunch of unique and interesting content. Well, this can be achieved in many ways. Let's divide our problem in two parts: generating the data and rendering the content. Procedural generation focuses only on generating the data, and there are various algorithms and techniques available to accomplish this. All of them have many pros and cons, and unfortunately, there isn't a straightforward way to choose one among the others. Which one is better for our scenario? Well, it's not easy to answer that question. It's essential to familiarize ourselves with as many techniques as possible and consider them as tools. With experience, we will learn how to recognize which techniques are best suited to our specific needs. For example, there is a grammar-based PCG, which is a technique that uses the grammar to provide a set of rules and symbols that defines how the content should be structured and generated. And it's often used to generate buildings and cities. Or there is L-systems, used a lot to generate plants or trees, a method for generating shapes and patterns by recursively applying a rule to a starting shape. Or again with function collapse, several automata, the various form of noise function, distribution, binary space partitionings, and many more. but you might find a list of the most used techniques everywhere. Let's create something using a parametric approach and render it. As the name suggests, the parametric approach is basically the definition of a set of parameters that can be adjusted to produce different results. This is what we want to generate, a procedural room for a fantasy dungeon. The input we want to specify is only the room size, and we want our algorithm to create the world layout for us. Our worlds are composed of smaller pieces, let's call them modules. One module is just a small mesh that represents the smallest part of what we want to create. Identifying all the modules of our procedural content is really important to define all the rules and compose our algorithm. Knowing the size of our models and the room size is easy to calculate how many models we need and what are their positions. Also, we can think about rescaling them a bit in order to fit the measure more precisely. To render the world, we can use a DrawMeshInstanced API, which is perfect for our use case, since we will change the room dimension at runtime. To use that, we just need a list of matrices that define the model's properties. Of course, you can also create a completely different configuration by arranging them using a different formula rather than in a straight line. To add variation to our basic case, we can introduce different modules and just between them with some kind of rule. We can also use randomness to lead the choice. The important thing is to remember to set the random initial state with a seed. To move from a single wall to a room, we can just repeat the procedure for the missing walls, the floor, and all the other pieces we want to add. To populate the room, we first created a grid system and assigned to each cell a tag based on its position and its side. So we have the inner cells and the outer cells. But also we can discriminate north, south, east and west. To insert the props, we check all the available positions in the grid and perform the probability check based on the cell's zone. Each zone had a different pool of possible objects, and every object had a different chance of being placed and a specific size. Once an object was placed, we updated the list of the available cells by removing the occupied ones. In addition, we could also mark certain areas as forbidden to prevent the object placement in those locations. By iterating through this simple algorithm, we were able to fill the room with a diverse range of objects, resulting in a fully decorated space. This is a basic scenario, but with the same techniques we have built all these other examples. Of course, sometimes we also added more polished rules or different inputs. Here, for instance, we use the mouse path rather than a length, but the core of the generation is the same. Procedural generation is a huge topic and we really love to experiment with different techniques and approaches. If you found this video interesting, we encourage you to try it out for yourself. In the description below, you'll find some resources, talks and articles that we found extremely helpful. let us know what you think in the comment below. Don't forget to subscribe, smash the like button, and follow us on the other socials. See you next time. Cheers.